The second Allen Experts panel will discuss legal challenges and business opportunities for ACES, autonomous, connected, electric, and shared mobility. To take part in this panel discussion, I would like to invite Professor Rajiv Khanna, Director, Faculty of Law, SGT University. When he retired from Faculty of Law, Delhi University in November 2012, Professor Khanna was the head and the dean of Faculty of Law, Delhi University. He started his career with the Faculty of Law in 1973. Am I corrected, sir? Was it 1968? You joined, right, sir. And he has written extensively on labor relations law and consumer protection laws. Professor Khanna's articles have been published in the Journal of the Indian Law Schools and also in some foreign journals. Professor Rajiv Khanna was also the coordinator IPR chair, University of Delhi under Ministry of MHRD. From 2004 to 2007, he was also the in charge of the Campus Law Center, Faculty of Law. From 2007 to 2009, he was visiting professor at Hankook University of Foreign Studies, Seoul, South Korea, where he was invited to set up their law school. Please welcome Professor Khanna with a loud round of applause. Sir, please. I would also like to invite Mr. Vineet Agarwal, General Counsel, BMW India. Presently heading the Legal Company Secretary and Compliance Function of BMW India. Sir?
I'll continue after that.
Presently heading the Legal Company Secretary and Compliance Function of BMW India, Mr. Agarwal, LLB, LLM, is an alumnus of the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, IIFT. With industry experience of more than 17 years, he has worked primarily within the auto industry, chiefly with Panasonic, JCB, and Maruti Suzuki. Welcome, Mr. Agarwal. May I also welcome Ms. Garima Sahni, partner, Sai Krishna Associates. Ms. Garima Sahni, a registered Indian patents agent and a patents attorney, leads the patents prosecution and analytics practice of the firm and plays a pivotal role in patent litigation matters as well. Ms. Sahni has dealt extensively with patent drafting, filing, prosecution, prior art searches, landscapes, claim mappings, due diligence, and validity assessments in several domains, including mechanical, automobile, telecommunication, software, biotechnology, pharma, and chemistry. She has also been involved in complex litigations in a variety of domains where she contributed immensely while working with technical experts. She routinely advises Fortune 500 companies and has in the past advised several firms, including MNCs, domestic firms, and startups. May I also invite once more Mr. Anuj Guglani to moderate the panel discussion. Please welcome all of them with some enthusiastic applause. Thank you.
Check. Okay, so friends, welcome back after the tea coffee break. So I hope you really liked the earlier panel. We tried to cover a whole host of issues, regulatory landscape, and now comes the action time on how to apply those regulations and standards and rules and laws that we have been mulling, the government is going to get very soon. It's time for ACES. ACES being autonomous, connected, electric, shared mobility, it's a reality. You cannot shy away from it. It's there, it's on your face. 5 years back, you could have never envisaged that Ola, Uber would, you know, penetrate our systems and lives so much. 5 years back, I had never thought that I will sell my car and completely depend on Ola, Uber. Yes, for family, we have vehicle, but for me, I don't have a vehicle. It's happened for the first time in 15 years, I don't have a personal vehicle. I completely rely on Ola and Uber. So the world is changing very, very fast. How well the regulation landscape is catching up, how well the rules are there. If you take an autonomous vehicle, if it meets with an accident, how do you fix the liability? Whose fault is it? Is it the OEM? Is it the computer? Is it the IT service provider, software provider? Is it the oncoming car, the oncoming vehicle? If the oncoming vehicle is also autonomous, then whose fault is it? It is that company's technology software, or if the other car is non-autonomous, semi-autonomous, lots of issues. Connected vehicle. Our vehicles were never this open to the world. 250 million connected vehicles all over the world in the next 2 years. Your car's computer would be exposed to the world. The hackers can get through the entertainment systems, open port, and control your car's airbags. They can control your car's braking system. They can swerve the vehicle. They can play some video on your entertainment system and distract you completely. It happened in the US 3 years back. The exactly same thing happened. Hackers from the other part of the world did that to the person. It was a Jeep Cherokee going in the US. So we are in a very, very different world right now. Okay, talking about shared mobility, if there is an accident, if there is a crime, how do you fix the liability? The companies very conveniently make the driver sign, you know, an agreement that, you know, you have to indemnify the company. And in your Ola or Uber app, you might have also said, I agree to those terms and conditions without even reading them. So legally, they might be safe, but what about ethically, morally, socially? So it's a huge topic of discussion. And to give a tech aspect and a flavor to it, we will begin this discussion with a video. Because it's about ACES, so it has to be about tech. So we have this brilliant short clip from BMW on tech. So can we have that video, please?
Anuj, before start this video, may I start the process? Just to give you a brief, we were in the Munich, all the general councils of the world sitting together with our group council, and chief strategy officer was present. He said, friends, we have a problem. We asked, what is the problem? We have the top brands in the world, top quality of the cars, so what is the problem? He said, one competitor is entering in our world. Competitor? Top one company? And who is entering here? He said, Mr. Google is entering in your world. What Mr. Google is doing to do? He said, now the world is changing. The change is inevitable. Now, car is not just a mobility solutions. I not need the car. I can go by the bicycle, I can go travel by that. But it is your extended living space. Why I'm saying extended living space? Just take your mobiles. I think most of the time we are not using just for communications. We are using for our emails, chatting and everything. So the bottom line is that we are now living in the technological world. Whether we want or not want, it is embedding in our lives. So just to give you a vision about the autonomous driving, what is we are looking for and how it is going to be in the future of the car. Yes, legal debate is going on. Just to give a flavor of that, I request, can you? Please sound that and just. It's very short clip, not just. And this is a real. Thank you. After that, there's one more video which can explain in much better way. It will again a very short clip. May I request for third clip, please? Yeah. This will help you to understand what is the connected.
Group is implementing fully autonomous driving over 5 levels of development. In the process, the responsibility for driving the car will shift from the person at the wheel to the car itself. Today, the second level has already been reached. Here, the driver is aided by assistance systems and can remove their hands from the steering wheel for brief periods. At the third level, they will sometimes be able to completely turn their attention away from driving, but must be able to step in again at short notice. Once level 4 is reached, the driver might even be able to sleep. They must, however, still be basically fit to drive in case they have to take over control of the car for specific sections of the journey. It is at the final level of development that cars will drive fully autonomously. The driver will become another passenger and won't even have to be able to drive, as the car will assume complete responsibility for the task of driving. At level 2, stereo cameras and radar sensors monitor the immediate surrounding area. Level 3 requires highly advanced sensors, such as laser scanners, ultrasonic sensors, and radar systems, which together produce a 360-degree model of the vehicle's environment. This makes it possible to calculate more complex driving maneuvers. For level 4, fully automated driving from 2021, all sensors and cameras will supply far more precise data, while the real-time data from the area maps provided by HERE will also be factored into the process of computing driving maneuvers. And level 5, the first pilot projects for fully autonomous driving are due to get underway in selected cities from as early as 2020. For the BMW Group, the vision of fully autonomous driving has long since begun.
So after that, seeing the same presentation, I challenged them, can they drive the car in Chandni Chowk? That will be a big question for us, where if they can test drive the vehicle in Chandni Chowk, I think this can withstand any part of the world. So basically, important point is technology is changing. Whether we want or not want, it has to be followed. And the important point, why this new autonomous driving, this process is going on, because people are looking, or the customer are looking, seeing as a car, not just a mobility solutions, but their living space. They need more comfort, more safety, and definitely the government or the public is looking for more safety environment in the whole structure. So that's, I open the forum for Anuj to express some points.
Well, Vineet, thank you very much for these two beautiful videos and really, you know, setting the perspective and the agenda. And yes, this Chandni Chowk thing sounds very familiar because, you know, even Google had touched base with us a couple of years back. They had said that they want to test some autonomous pods in Chandni Chowk. So I had asked them why. They said that's such rich, precious research data. You know, if we can do something there, and it can run there, it can probably run anywhere in the world. And even if it fails, it'll be good experimental data for us. So yes, the prerequisite for these autonomous vehicles or level 4, level 5 autonomous vehicles is good public infrastructure. Because these vehicles have to identify the lanes, they have to identify the turns, the signals, intersections, bus stops. There, this Aadhaar 2.0, which I had mentioned in my presentation, can somehow help you. Which can help you go beyond those multiple agencies. Like, you know, near my place, in Arkepuram, at the Kamakoti Marg intersection, if you have to take a right turn, there is a electric pole and there is the traffic light right behind the electric pole. Now, going by chicken and egg, I don't know which came first, which came later. Whether someone put the electric pole in front of the traffic light, the traffic light came behind the, you know, electric pole, but you cannot see the traffic light and it is so distractive, so confusing. So because there are multiple agencies, PWD might say, I put the pole, my job is done. Or some agency might say, I put the signal, my job is done. But where is the integration? That's where probably a centralized road safety authority can play a big role. If we buy a small ketchup sachet also at McDonald's or KFC, it cannot be sold to a consumer without a FSSAI certification number, right? But in our country, you can make any flyover, you can make any turn, any road, you can change the infrastructure without any such approval. So there has to be a centralized road safety agency, which a part of it is already being proposed in the amendment, but they are still not clear. As even Akshay had mentioned, it's pretty ambiguous. But we need a centralized authority, then possibly these autonomous vehicles can see the light of the day. At the same time, it is a big political issue, because it has been made a political issue by the parties and the government that this will kill jobs. And it sounds very similar to when horse carriages were going away and the automobile was coming in. People thought that horse carriage drivers will lose jobs, but actually they upskilled and they got better jobs. So, and at the same time, level 2, level 3 autonomous can be very good for safety. Already in the US, you have almost every car company which they have launched products which have emergency braking. If you get distracted, if you are not paying attention to the vehicle in front of you, if you're just about to collide, it brakes on your behalf. It, there's an emergency brake, because if it doesn't, the accident, the collision is inevitable. So we have to actually see, we have to actually draw a line, draw a blueprint, how autonomous vehicles can be adopted, how we can embrace them, because it just might be an idea whose time has come and you just can't shun it away. Like Ola, when Uber came in the world, there were so many protests across the world. The London Taxi Association was protesting, European Union was protesting, all the unions of all the taxis were protesting. But because Uber was so consumer friendly, it had aligned around the consumer. When the consumer says, I want something, nobody can stand a chance. So technology, when it connects to consumer, how we can be the enablers, that can be part of our discussion. So Garima, you are the leading IP attorney of the country or probably of the world. And you are also our platinum partner. So I have a right to, you know, offer a lot of adulations to you. So what are your thoughts on ACES and with respect to the Indian standpoint?
Definitely, I think we are at the right time discussing this topic. We can't say that we can go fully autonomous in next few years because we know Indian infrastructure won't allow us to do that, even in the best of the top cities, I would say the 5 top cities or metropolitan cities, that we will have infrastructure problems. But if you see where we are today, you would realize that we are at least partially autonomous. You see, we have cars today where we can put on the car on autopilot mode and we can just relax. We don't need to have to, when we're on highway or on high speed or a consistent speed stage, we don't have to monitor what the car is doing. We can just set the speed and it goes on. That's also autonomous pilot, autonomous vehicle mode. Now, we're already there, but the only concern that I have here is that we are switching fast towards the autonomous thing. When we'll go fully will depend on what Indian government does with the infrastructure, how we take it. But yes, as on date, there are no laws in place which actually takes care of the situation of where the liability goes. There are traditional laws which will take care of the situations that whether it's a product liability, was the accident or the misfortune happened because of the product defect, or was it a tort liability, whether the driver was at fault, identification of the person who was at fault. Sometimes it's only a cow in India, you know, and the cases will just run because the driver just could not control the car. It was just an animal on road, and because of which a misfortune happened. But with autonomous vehicles, the liability, there'll be such big supply chain that the liability assurance will get so complicated. It can be the driver. The definition of the driver will become so important. In some of the countries, the definition of driver is a person who is sitting on the driver's seat. But in certain countries, they say that you need not sit on the driver's seat, you should be able to control the vehicle or just engage the vehicle in operation or put it in operation. Now, in India, when it comes to our legal framework, we'll have to work around and probably evolve the definition of driver a little bit because to accommodate partial autonomy, also to accommodate fully autonomous vehicles. Similarly, the second member in the supply chain, as far as liabilities are concerned, can be the car manufacturer, who will actually be held responsible for all the defects in the components that it is procured from the OEMs, then again a partial or say a collaborative liability may be there because something has been provided to the car manufacturer from the OEM, but the car manufacturer took a call that whether I have to purchase this, whether it is the best component that I'm purchasing, whether I have actually done all the checked all the safety requirements or not. Then the third comes in the picture is the entity that owns the brand, like say Maruti or BMW or Tata. Now, there have been instances in the, so for example, Volvo is a very good example who has taken full responsibility of any misfortune that happens. It's Volvo and it has been actually acknowledged by a lot of standard setting organizations like IEEE and others. And these platforms have come forward and have said that, yes, the company provider, the company is responsible to provide the technology. It's not the users or the passengers or the customers who will have to take the liability on their head. They should be busy doing something else while we commit and promise that we'll provide a safe solution to them. And third, I would say in this autonomous vehicle, the liability point can be the service provider who has given the autonomous technology. Now here, there can be a complicated situation because a software provider can provide the best of software, which was working fine at the time when it was being it had been provided, but eventually during the use, it may go corrupt. There may be bugs, there may be hackings, there may be malfunctions, or it's possible that the user did not update it as per the instructions of the software provider. Because we know that the softwares have to be updated every now and then. It's possible that there was a notification, and due to lack of time or just due to ignorance, the user, which is a driver, failed to kind of update that software module, which is why the misfortune may occur. So the liability then again, it's between the driver who did not update it and the software provider, and the software was acting in collaboration with the hardware component, which should actually also have built in, it should have been evolved by design way. So there'll be multiple factors, it will get very complicated. But yes, as compared to last 2 years when we were discussing this topic, it has finally come to a stage where we can at least identify who will be the relevant stakeholders in the supply chain, where the liabilities can be pushed and who have to take accountability.
I think that's a very good synopsis, Garima. Really appreciate your points. In fact, taking a cue from Garima's discussion, as she mentioned that there could be a joint ownership, responsibility, liability of the driver, because the driver's definition just might change or expand. So you never know, 10, 15 years down the line, you might be holding a joint license, you know, with an OEM. You know, that on my license, I might have my name, Anuj, and also an OEM. That, hey, this company, and also probably Infosys, you know, so probably I might have a joint license with, say, Maruti, Infosys, Wipro, and of course, I'm there. So you never know, because it's joint. So why should the liability be only be mine or just be of the OEM? And yes, about these virus hacks or software not getting updated, it is very similar to the recall. If the recall notice has been served, the person not getting the vehicle for the repair or fixing, then how do you fix whose fault it is? Or it could be as simple or blatant as, you know, I took a pen drive from the DJ last evening after the wedding program and I put it in my car, virus went into the system and it hacked my entire car. You never know. Because even in the US, that the hackers entered the Jeep Cherokee ECU from the open port in the entertainment system. They were just casually browsing. Aaj kiski vaat lagaye? Actually, they were just casually browsing. Who's vulnerable today? Whom do I mess up today? Whose life do I destroy today? It was actually, you know, God's divine, it was probably divine intervention. That person was saved. He was going at a good speed on the freeway. It could have turned anyway, you know. And that guy was so shocked and frightened and completely psyched out. You know, if you read his, his blog, if you just read his words, you can feel the terrible, you know, agony he went through after that, accident. So actually, these can be accidents. Even now, if you see the data which is published by the government and many other agencies, you know, we very conveniently say 49% accident due to driver's error. You know, and it very conveniently also hides the wrong design of the roads, the wrong design of the fly over the traffic light behind the electric pole and all those things. Do you ever read in any report or research data that this accident happened because of bad road design or because of a faulty traffic light or because the traffic light was behind the electric pole? You will never read anywhere. So it's always the driver because it's very convenient. So Vinit, would you like to shed some light on these issues?
First of all, very important thing here, since technology has not been developed so far, so I'm sure the government is still struggling their heads what can be the possible solution. As of now, Germany has in 2017 introduced a law which has enabled the provision for the semi-automatic driving. And already some of the cars are semi-automatic. It is already driven on the road smoothly. As far as the contemplation of the government is, they will propose to install a black box-like thing in the car. When you turn the car in automatic mode, two things are important. One, the driver or the person who is driving the car has always the authority to take over the automatic driving automatically. Second, the driver has to be very vigilant and cognizant of the fact what is the surrounding movement is going on, meaning thereby, if anything which is apparent which can cause an accident, so he should take over the car, control of the car. In terms of legal liability, if the driver is not prudent, driver is responsible. However, if there is a manufacturing defect because of software failures, and the manufacturer is responsible. So in terms of, it's evolving process, but as of now, written law is concerned, it is only Germany has introduced so far. I think progressively it's will evolve.
One thing that I want to add here is that definitely after the autonomous vehicles will enter India, the drivers will be at ease because the liabilities will clearly shift from the driver liabilities or the tort liabilities will decrease and product liabilities will increase. And on the product side, it will be only the manufacturers and the OEMs and the software providers. So drivers can actually hope for a good, good time ahead.
Okay, so Professor Saab, what are your views on this emerging topic and these emerging technologies in the automotive space?
It's the future. Like at tea I said, we are talking of recall. In India, how many recalls have taken place? The answer is zero. It's a reality. There has been no recall. What we are talking of is maybe 10 years from today in India. Well, safety, automation. You go to the Yamuna Express Highway, world class, excellent. But how do you prevent the villager from crossing the road? Where does the safety come in? The only way is that while we are designing these highways, there should be sufficient underpasses which will connect one village to the other. The villager going from one village to the district, or maybe the farmer to sell the produce. How do we take care of it? We have also to take care of our economy. And on the one hand, the automation on the other hand. Yes, we have it. We are moving ahead at a very fast pace. But are we geared for it? We have to. With the education spreading all over the country, educated youth also, and everybody, as Ramaswamiji stated, while traveling in the train from Kerala to New Delhi, he was surprised, wonderstruck, that every village had the solar system. And it's not only the solar electric system, but also the cultural revolution which has brought in with the mass media. So we are geared for it.
Absolutely. So we are in a way connected. And yes, talking about solar, we are the fifth largest solar producer in the world now, which is a big thing. And recently our Prime Minister Modi ji got that International Solar Alliance Award also jointly. So coming to the sea of aces, and by the way, sir, recalls, there are a lot of OEMs which are very responsible. And I would say companies like Maruti, a lot of Japanese companies, they very openly, voluntarily, they do the recalls because they feel it's their duty. It's their responsibility to the customer and his or her family. And at the cost of the public outcry or, you know, effect on image, because the media publishes it front news. XYZ company recalls so many cars because of the ABC issue. It goes against the brand, but an intelligent customer, which is getting intelligent and mature and evolved, they have started appreciating. If you see the Toyota debacle, actually it was the biggest opportunity. The year, couple of years back, when Toyota had this massive recall, it was in millions of vehicles, billions of dollars were spent, the uncontrolled acceleration. And that was because of the doormat in the driver's well. And that was, of course, from the vendor. It was in a way, it was there for, because they should have been careful during the vendor selection, quality, R&D, sampling. But it happened. And the global head of Toyota bowed down towards in front of media. He held a big media press conference in different parts of the world, and he was bowing down and publicly acknowledging, apologizing. There was also a case, it was a freak case, where a customer had driven down his vehicle down to the Toyota workshop to get this problem fixed because it was part of the recall. That customer's date was scheduled much later, but he came, you know, he jumped the queue. So he was very impatient, and in his impatience, what he did, he knowingly drove the vehicle at full speed and rammed the vehicle full speed in an adjoining shop, and citing the reason that this was uncontrolled acceleration. Toyota paid for all the damages. Toyota even apologized to that customer despite having a doubt that there's a malfeasance. And in the same year, they broke all sales records also. They were the number one car maker in the world. So customers are evolving, markets are evolving, customers know that when it's a recall, voluntary, when it is in the guise of campaign. So customers getting smart that way. Yes, Vineet.
Yeah, especially for it's so bigger topics, but for the connected drive, there are four buckets, which is important. One is the privacy to respect. One, the data of the person who's traveling, and second is the data of the car. Again, it's a whole plethora of the issues, what the privacy we want to protect and what not. Second is the accident. Whose liability, a manufacturer's or the driver? Third is the insurance. Who and who is liable to pay the insurance? And fourth is the telecom networks, because definitely it cannot work. Any connected drive cannot work, any autonomous driving cannot work without the networks, where you have a seamless network across the globe or across the India. So that's all about the issues relating to the autonomous driving.
Yeah, please, sure. Please, Garima.
So, sir just mentioned the issue of telecom sector. Now, it's very interesting. In fact, two conferences back, I spoke on this very issue, and I'm glad that this issue has come up again. If anyone of you is following what is happening in the telecom sector, there had been cases on standard and essential patents, you know, because these technologies are standard technologies. I'll give you a small example. If my car is an autonomous car, and I decide that if my car has to be connected with a satellite and with a remote processor or a controller, and it's operating at a frequency of, say, 65 megahertz, then all the cars around me have to operate at that same frequency, and all the operators at the back end should coordinate with each other. Otherwise, they'll never be able to. One is operating at 35, one is operating at 65. It'll be a total chaos. Same way over the phone, same thing over the phone. If I am talking, or say, just as a human being, if I'm talking in French, you're talking in English, we'll never be able to understand. When we talk about connected car, they have to talk the same language, they have to use the same technology, they have to interact with the tower in the same way, the tower has to talk the same code that the car is capable to encode. No technologies can work in isolation. Now, this exact thing was witnessed by the telecom industry, where there were some standard-setting organizations like ISO, IEEE, and ISIS, and all these companies, they laid down some standard technologies, and they mandated the phone manufacturers that if you are making a mobile phone or any telecom device that is using 2G, 3G, 4G network, you have to follow these standard technologies. There cannot be any other way around it. Because if the tower is giving you 35 megahertz frequency, you have to follow 35 megahertz. You can't decide that I will not follow 35, I will have my own frequency. That's not possible with standard technologies. When this happened, there was obviously an abuse of dominance by the companies who proposed 35 megahertz. Because then everybody, and if they had a patent over it, everybody was bound to use that patent. Even they want it or they don't want it, they were forced to use that patent and be in the situation where they had no other choice. Now, the similar thing will happen to the automobile industry also when the connected cars will be in full swing on the roads. I think it's time that we prepare in advance for that. And I'm not sure if a lot of companies have got the love letters already from the telecom companies, because they now all the cars are connected. Even though they're not autonomous, there are SIMs going, there are chipsets going into the cars, which keeps you connected. You can take your mobile, your calls on the cars. So the telecom companies are very aggressive in litigation and enforcing their rights. So I think this is another one very, very important aspect that the legal framework makers will have to think, consider about it, that when it comes to connected cars, how will abuse of dominance be taken care of? How the standard essential patents will be taken care of, and when they come to the ground, how the rights of the implementers will also be taken care of.
Great. So I think just the way we have the standards of the frequency in the telecom, I think it's time that the legal fraternity also, you know, they put their heads together with the government and get the standards on the law as well. Otherwise, it just hits you one day that this is it, you have to do it. So it's better, it is prudent, we start the process now, we make it consultative. We present, we probably prepare some synopsis, some, you know, background, some paper, present it to the government, you know, discuss it with the OEMs and take it forward in the win-win way. And Professor Saab, you have seen the world, you have so much of experience. Whenever some new technology or, you know, comes which completely takes you by surprise and people are confused, which might happen in this ACES also, how have people reacted in the past, and what you feel is the best way to move forward to embrace change?
Well, we have to accept the changes. And in India, fortunately enough, we are accepting them now. And all the rapid changes are being accepted. Because, you know, past few years, the level of education through mass media has spread all over the country. All villages have been connected. And everybody, we are the most literate country now in the world. The rate of literacy and also, I would say, employment has increased. So we are accepting all new technologies and moving ahead. So.
Wow, that's fantastic, sir. So much positivity coming from your end. It's really inspirational for us. So friends, in this ACES story, I think we've covered all, but I think this E is feeling a bit left out. So before we open the panel to Q&A, let's talk about this E. E is for electric. We've had a lot of discussions on electric in the earlier panel too. Government was going very, very, you know, ballistic on electric till last year. Suddenly something happened and little more room was given to the manufacturers, to the ecosystem to develop. The manufacturers, the ecosystem still feels there is ambiguity in the policy. There is no policy. There is no clarity. But at the same time, if we talk about plainly two things, okay, I think I'm audible. Yeah. So we talk about two things in electric specifically. One, where does the power come from? What I had shared in my presentation too, that if 68% of the electricity is coming from fossil fuels, is the EV really green? What is the plan on that? What are the compliances? What is the regulation? And the policymakers are pushing now for 100% EV. Is it really for environment, or is it to give a viability to the people who have purchased expensive coal blocks? So I'm being very, you know, fair and open. Second point, the recycling of the batteries. Lithium ion battery is there in this phone too, in all your smartphones. These lithium ion batteries sneak into the landfill, we don't even get to know. It releases toxins in the landfill, it leads to leaching. The toxins go to the groundwater, come to our stomach. Just imagine, this is such a small battery, a 10 times bigger size goes to the landfill. What happens? So where are we on recycling? Where are we on compliances? What are the regulations for EV? If Garima, you would like to shed some light on that?
So definitely when we talk about EV, we don't want that we come out of air pollution problem and we enter into the landfill problem. We don't certainly don't want that. And there has to be some commitment from the government to first bring in robust policy for the automobile manufacturers, who will then see some hope in the market that yes, there is proper policy which is promoting the use of electric vehicles. There has to be some incentivization. There has to be some leverages on the tax side and some other benefits given to the people who are investing into production of electric vehicles. And then secondly, I think it's so important that the infrastructure has to be seen from a different perspective. It's not possible to change the current infrastructure altogether. We can't have the battery charging stations being placed at the regular petrol pump, somewhere in South X. We will have a total chaos. That road is already in so much of chaos because of the metro construction and other factors. It's so busy road, we can't have, and any other road in Delhi, I think there are hardly any roads which are peaceful and isolated in India. That way Delhi is getting safer, I would say, because 24 hours traffic every time on roads. So so what I'm trying to say is that we need to think very, very carefully as to what kind of infrastructure do we need for electric vehicles, and are we ready to spend that much of effort and energy onto laying down a complete different infrastructure, because the existing infrastructure may not be able to give that much of charging time and that much of space to accommodate the huge battery size. And because obviously from the R&D side there will be constraints, we can't have mini batteries, we'll have to have batteries that can run a vehicle. So these are some points.
Great. In fact, if you ask me for an EV revolution in India, first of all, if we need an EV revolution, we actually don't need charging stations right away. What my belief is, in fact, what we had presented the same thing to Neeti also in our that's eight pointer, that if we just focus on two-wheelers, on e-rickshaw, on auto, rickshaw and buses, we are looking at a segment which comprises 85% of the vehicles by volume. They contribute 30% to the pollution. They consume 75% of the fuel. And fuel is imported. It's a big draw on the import bill. If we just fix this piece, we don't need a charging station network right away. So that can also be a very important food for thought for us, for the policymakers, to have the right EV strategy. EV and also plug-in hybrid can be a midway stop, because you have to make the people used to a plug-in and to kill the range anxiety issue. So it can be a plug-in hybrid.
Or it can just be a battery swapping system.
Battery swapping, which
you don't need a battery charging station at all. You just need a battery charging swapping point, which can be any store.
Well said.
A provisional store, I would say.
Exactly. In fact, one of the leading gas companies of the world actually approached us in understanding how from their existing network of gas, they can probably do battery swapping, because the mandate of the government of India is that it should take the same time which it takes to refuel the conventional fuel, you do a battery swapping. It's a phenomenal idea. If we can pull it, it'll be a global case study. And I really wish from the bottom of my heart that we're able to pull it off. At the Neeti program, during one of the panels, I asked them a question. It was a panel which comprised experts from all over the world in EV. I had posed the question, can you please share your case studies or use cases on battery swapping? You know what was their response? They asked me, what is battery swapping? So there is not a single use case of battery swapping anywhere in the world, but our government is going full on onto it, and I really hope we are able to pull it off. And if we do it, it will be kudos. So I think just let's open it to the Q&A round. If we have some questions, Baseen Saab, ko mic dijiye please.
So two points. First of all, very informative discussion there. In fact, the stuff is too large for the 40 or minutes discussion which you have
Absolutely.
Kept.
Absolutely.
This time is so less. I mean, we have missed out so many points. And each point can, its own, it probably mandates another 45 minutes discussion on each point. Just to react on the last point on this battery swapping thing, I don't think it's going to be very easy. Battery contains sulfuric acid, the current batteries. Batteries contain other chemicals also. If you're thinking of swapping at a mass scale, and India produces, Maruti alone produces 1.5 lakh vehicles per month, 18 lakh vehicles per year. Maruti is 50%, another 18 lakh, around 4 million cars we are selling, out of which even if 10% are battery operated in the coming years. Incidentally, that reminds me, one of the Scandinavian countries, either Sweden or Norway, is on 39% on battery use. The EV proportion of the total vehicle is 39%. That's very, very high. So maybe we can study that also. So this is a little area where one should work a lot. It's not going to be easy from, the handling point of view. But I want to react more on the earlier part where you mentioned about the autonomous vehicle. Autonomous vehicle is good. We are all capable of producing it. But in my view, and many people ask, being a part of the car companies, this question whether this will work. In my opinion, producing the autonomous car is not a problem. Matching the frequencies is not a problem at all. The problem is the environment in which, like Chandni Chowk, one of the examples just given, which is out of our control, the problem is that area. If I live that longer, probably we cannot use autonomous car in India for next 50 years. It's just not possible. You cannot control the traffic. There's a big discussion on the EVs or this e-rickshaws, which we call it in Delhi, going on. They have become now probably 2-3 years old. It's, apart from the creating the traffic problem, they're also creating maintenance problems. Their speeds have come down and there are many other things. This is not under our control. Oh, Hindi mein, Punjabi mein kehte hain, reda aa gaya. Reda means anything, you know. How will you control all those people? I live in Bombay, but I belong to Delhi. I live in Pune also. I have a house in Singapore also where my children stay, and I just returned 4-5 days ago. I live there. People go and visit. I live there. I have a house there. I was reading some very good news in one of the parking lots below our house. It was mentioned, this is a dangerous place. One person died in the last 6 years. What is that? One person dying in 6 years and they are displaying it. It's a place called Simei in East. It's near Changi Airport in Singapore. I was very pleased and amused also to read what is this. And in our, we were reading this, 4 people dying every minute or something like that. We cannot control this. Anuj, my problem is, my thought process is, we can produce good cars, but then how we have excelled in satellite and ISRO and something, because there is no outside world. True. The people produce the product and they send it in satellite. Good, gone. No Chandni Chowk there.
In fact, Ms. Chaudhary's point is very relevant, what she had mentioned in her comments, during the CWG Games 2010, the entire city had transformed. So efficient, so process-driven, so clean, so disciplined. So it's a will, it's the enforcement. And I think it's time because, somewhere our government also gets weak. We have this vote bank thing because of vote bank or religion or, reservations. The governments get weak because they also need to get the mandate. They also need to win elections. That makes them weak. So somewhere things need to be fixed. And if you go out and try to fix, you are taken as a dictator or, as a tyrant. So it's really not easy. There are no quick fixes, no right answers.
One last point before I close. I'll give an example of Bombay again. In Delhi, on traffic intersections, I rarely find police people. And people here outside, they say normally that out there in Bombay, the traffic sense is better. I don't know which one is better because I've lived in both places. In Bombay, in every intersection, on an average, there are 4 police people. And there must be 2,000 or 3,000 intersections. They are very, very heavy traffic intersections, like Saki Naka is one place, for example, Andheri. It's notoriously famous. So 2,000 into probably 4, probably 20 or 15,000 of the police nakas, and then they cannot control these auto rickshaws of Bombay once again. It's very difficult to control. Delhi wala phir bhi haath deta hai, murta hai. Wo to, these people do not listen.
True,
that's the problem. So where will the autonomous vehicle go?
Right, sir.
That's my just a comment.
I will partially answer this, with just taking the lead. 2 things very important. Technology will change, whether we want or don't want. Second thing, yes, 100% automated driving is not just a dream, but process is already on. Semi-auto system is already on. It is already also available in the Indian markets.
Yes, absolutely.
Semi. So definitely,
semi, and it have technological advantage, it will reduce your risk of accidents, technically possible. It will change.
Great, that's fantastic. My take on that. So any other question or we wrap up the panel? Yes, Mr. Amit Asija, Sika.
Very good to see beautiful discussion going on autonomous vehicles, electric vehicles. Everybody gearing up for the future. I will not speak about technology now. I just wanted to understand, like everybody was saying that roads are not ready. Situation of traffic is bad. But at the same time, I would also want to know what is the legal network or the legal, all the senior people sitting around over here doing about the current infrastructure. Are we really prepared for this autonomous vehicles? We don't have control on the existing vehicles, especially on the aftermarket side. We still lack on the quality of the jobs we do. People are going for bonding and riveting. We are still with gas welding. Even I would not want to name, it would not look very fair. In fact, in the best of the best OEM dealerships, you will still find gas welding being used on the crash, on the accidental vehicles. Is it really safe? Like, we are speaking of autonomous vehicles. Are we capable to handle it? Is our network capable to handle it? But does the government have an regulation on the cars getting repaired? Are the cars which are getting repaired in the crash repair, are they roadworthy to drive?
That's a very valid point, Amit, that you have raised, that we need to first get the basics in place, need to get the basic house, basic safety in order, and then we can talk about the emerging tech. But you know, we can always harmonize. You know, just because one thing is not being focused on, that actually will not stop the emerging tech to enter. Just because my personal vehicle might not be that good enough, it'll never stop. Just because my existing taxi network might not be good enough, it didn't stop Ola or Uber to come in. So many a times things come in, they become, you know, omnipresent. It's just on the touch of your mobile, you know, things happen. And yes, it's a very valid point. These safety things need to be considered. In fact, I covered in my presentation also as part of HSSE that too, we tried to cover. So any other question or observations, Ram sir? Yes, sir.
See, one, two, three things I'd like to sum up. Technology is the future. There is no two way about it. So innovation is going to be there. Next comes challenges. Challenges will bring out solutions also. Let's take simple examples. Yesterday in CPI, I saw that now multi-level parkings are getting created. If we think about solutions, maybe very soon you will have structure upon structure upon structure in terms of, you know, circular highways or other things coming up. I'm not an expert, but I'm just thinking aloud. So doubting promises will always be there, but whichever government will be in place will have to look at solutions. 1991, when liberalization happened, we said, mar jayenge. Mare to nahi hai na, aage hi badhe hum log. So like that, you know, future is there. Huh. Legality-wise, one point which really troubles me is that if everything is to go autonomous, then who will be held accountable?
Big issue. Big issue.
And I'm reminded of this movie Sully, in case somebody has seen that movie, wherein actually the pilot, him by Tom Hanks, brings that aircraft into the Hudson River. And thereafter, they simulate this entire example through technology. Finally, even they are unable to, you know, bring out as to how he was able to navigate and bring it to a level that no human being left. Because that was a human intervention which happened. Similarly here, autonomous may come, but you cannot dispense with the human angle to it.
Fair enough. The strength of the human spirit. So fine. So I think on that, we'll wrap up the panel. Thank you so very much, fellow panelists. And thank you very much, Vineet, for the brilliant videos. Thank you, Professor Saab. Thank you, Garima. for the giving the snapshot as an IP specialist. So, do we break for lunch or do we have two more keynotes? What say? I think we can break for lunch possibly. And then we can, so the two keynotes which are supposed to be pre-lunch, let's have them after lunch. Yeah. Right? Yeah, let's do that, yeah.
I would like to invite on stage Mr. Ramaswamy from Medha Advisors and Mr. Adarsh Verma from the Exhibition India Group to please come forward and felicitate our panelists. Give them a round of applause, everyone. That was Mr. Vineet Agarwal and, Ms. Garima Sahni and Mr. Vineet Agarwal. So please join them for a photo. Aapka? Acha.
Just kidding.
Yes, I thought we gave one to you. Yes, sir. Ji. Thank you so much, gentlemen. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so friends, let's break for lunch. And I hope 45 minutes are sufficient for a nice lunch and nice discussion. And how many of you have your Navratra fast today? Please raise your hands. So we have Navratra food too. Please don't miss that. All right? And yes, the same rule applies, the house rule. Once the session begins, anyone who joins late has to come on stage, dance or sing a song. Okay? Thank you. And I'm excluded, exempted. Thank you.